Good evening and welcome to this month's Crime Call.
Your help and your calls will hopefully once again solve a number of crimes.
Tonight, the disappearance of Deirdre Jacob, her family make a new appeal.
You wake in the middle of the night and we'll have a discussion about it. We'll be talking about it. We'll just say, what happened to Deirdre? Where is she?
And we reconstruct a number of armed raids in County Carlow.
You! Not the fucking box! Fucking head up!
Despite all of our best intentions to keep our children safe when we travel, 80% of us are incorrectly fitting their car seats.
We look at the effects of collisions on children. We show you how to fit the seats.
As ever, we look for your help to identify suspects caught on security cameras.
Like the men carrying out these two recent raids in Dublin and Kildare.
Thank you also for all of your calls last month. We had a great response from you on all of the cases that we featured.
We looked for information on an unsolved case in Galway as Gorthy tried to identify this English busker whose remains were discovered buried in the backyard of a house in Salthill in 2002.
There was a huge response from you, in particular from people involved in the music scene at the time.
Several of you phoned with leads on where Dave was living in the 1990s.
And Gardaí are following up on all of your information now. Thank you very much. Because you might be excused for occasionally thinking that cases stretching back as far as 2002 are going to be ones that we would get little or no reaction to, but the fact is, we do.
We do indeed, and we have another cold case tonight, and we're equally hopeful of getting a similar reaction.
Another incident that we featured last month was a morning raid in the post office in Mohill, County Leitrim. Armed men had been watching the post office circling the town in a red Mazda, waiting for their opportunity to strike.
Fill the bag up!
Fill it up!
Give us the money!
Fill it up! Come on! Give us the money! Give us the money!
Come on! Will you?
There was a huge response to that reconstruction.
Again, lots of calls from you with possible suspects, and your leads are being followed up by Gardaí in Leitrim.
We also showed you jewellery recovered by the organised crime unit in Operation Fiacla.
Over 1,000 pieces of stolen jewellery were waiting to be reunited with owners. You got in touch and most of it has now been returned to its owners. As a result, charges have been brought against those who took the valuables in the first place.
As always, our call takers will be here till 11:30 tonight and our number is 1800 40 50 60 or you can free text CRIME followed by your information to 50123.
And you're quick off the mark already. If you're calling from Northern Ireland, our number is 08000 393 393.
Greg, how did we do on CCTV last month?
Well, we had a great response on the phones last month. One suspect handed himself in after the programme and four more people were identified from the calls we got and those cases are progressing. But there was one piece that we're still looking for leads on. We're going to reshow that later on in the programme.
OK, let's look at our first piece tonight and it's a robbery.
That's right, the first piece, it's from service station in Chapelizod in Dublin on Monday the 4th of February at 9:30 in the evening. And that's the raider that we want to try and identify tonight. So let's take a look at the footage and see what actually happened in Chapelizod in Dublin 10. So he arrived in this blue Audi. Now straight away we can see he's covered up as he jumps out of the car and he has a bag with him. Now when he comes into the shop he approaches the staff member, threatens her with a gun which you can see quite clearly and tells her he wants her all the money that's in the till. Now the Audi that he arrived in was bearing cloned registration plates. It was actually taken in a burglary in Ballyfermot on the 29th of January and it was then discovered on the 5th of February in the steeples in Chapelizod. So perhaps somebody might have seen that car around and if it was parked offside somewhere. 11D17270 was the registration on it. Maybe you saw it acting suspiciously and you might be able to help us tonight. So that's some footage of the man leaving with a second person driving and here's the photos we took of him while he was in the shop carrying out that raid.
His half his face is covered, but we have made identifications and nominations before based on just half a face.
Yeah, from similar photographs, so hopefully tonight the same thing will happen.
Okay, should somebody recognise him, please do get in touch. We're next off to Limerick.
Yeah, that's right. This is a criminal damage incident from an ATM from Parkway Shopping Centre in Limerick. Now, it's from the 3rd of November last year. There's one man that we want to identify. That's him there. That's probably the best photo we could take from it. It's not that great, but let's take a look at the footage and perhaps it'll help people in recognising him. So when he came in, this, as we saw, the best images we got was where when he was coming in the front door. Now, he approaches the ATM machine. He has that bag with him and he took out a drill. We can see clearly in a moment here, it was a yellow drill. He drilled two holes in the ATM machine, causing some serious damage to it. So he leaves almost straight away after he drills the holes. But the best images we got were when he was coming in the front door. So we're going to just show that photo again. Again, it's one where he's wearing a hood. Mm-hmm. You can only kind of see half of his face, but you never know. Someone might be able to identify him from that.
Absolutely, and if you do, you know what to do. Next, we're off to County Kildare, and it's another armed robbery.
Yeah, this is a robbery from a shop in Monreid Avenue in Naas in County Kildare. Now, this one occurred on Friday, October the 10th, at 10 past 3 in the afternoon last year. That's the man we want to identify, and we'll take a look at what happened inside this shop. Now, initially, we're just going to show a couple of moments of him walking through the aisles in the shop, because that's when we get our best images of mm-hmm. him. There's one here in particular where he walks towards the camera. Now, I know he is wearing a cap, but I think he's still recognisable yeah. from those images. Now, when he came back to the counter, he took out a standing knife and he took cash from the till here, as we can see quite clearly, and then he left quite quickly. Now, he got into a dark Peugeot, possibly a 206 or a 306 model. So hopefully tonight, with that photo we're going to show there and the information about that car, somebody might be able to put the two of those together and come up with a name for us.
Absolutely. Let's take a look again at the best of the images of this round of CCTV.
Yeah, so the first one we'll take a look at is the robbery that occurred in Chapel Izzet in Dublin there. That was the man who was armed with the gun. And then we'll show the man in Limerick damaging the ATMs. And then lastly again, the man who was involved in that robbery in Naas in County Kildare.
Okay, Greg, thanks very much. We'll see you later. Now, you'll have heard about developments in the case of Ciara Breen, missing from Dundalk since 1997.
On a crime call last January, Ciara's mother made this appeal.
I had one, just one little girl. My heart, my soul, my world. And just like that, she was gone. She was not street smart. She paid the price. And if anything comes out of this, I would like it to be yes for whoever has the information we need for Ciara to give it. Please, please, don't let her lie out there on her own anymore. Let her come home.
Well, as a result of that crime call appeal, someone did come forward. A man was arrested and a file is being prepared for the Director of Public Prosecutions. And Gordy in Dundalk would like to thank you very much for your help.
And we would like to thank you as well, because for the families of the missing, this is a search that never ends. Like Deirdre Jacob, she went missing in July 1998. She was 18 years old. Her parents joined us in studio earlier on, but a few years ago we visited them in Kildare.
Well, there's Deirdre. What age is she?
Deirdre was about two and a half when that was taken. Yeah. And this one was taken when she was at primary school in Newbridge.
Yes.
She played the piano and the guitar. She was bright, bubbly, outgoing. Deirdre went to St Mary's Teacher Training College in Strawberry Hill in Twickenham in England, and she had just completed her first year when she came home, and she was very happy with the course she chose.
That one was in
this was taken in her room in St Mary's in Strawberry Hill, yeah. Taken by one of her fellow students. This one, I think, is Misty, isn't it?
That's Misty in that. Yes, indeed, yes.
And Deirdre loved to spend time with the dogs. And when she was away at college, she missed the dogs, always inquiring in how they were. Misty.
It's Misty, indeed. The day she went missing, that was the 28th of July. She left the house sometime after 1 o'clock. She walked the 25 minutes into town, went to the granny's shop, who was with her for a little while, and then she proceeded to the bank, and she had a bank draft to send to her college friend in London. and from the bank to the post office, and then returned back to the granny shop, which was about about 2:30. She remained there for a couple of minutes and then proceeded to walk home.
I arrived home from work just sometime before 7 o'clock. My mother was with me also. And when we arrived at the door and I rang the bell, there was no reply. So I was immediately alarmed because Deirdre should have been there.
I drove the road back into town a couple of times. And then somewhere between 9:30 and 10 o'clock, I went to the Gardaí. From there on then, the search got into full swing. The area around our home, people were searching right through the night, and that search and investigation then continued. It may be in the middle of the night, you wake in the middle of the night and we'll have a discussion about it. You know, we'll just say, what happened to Deirdre? Where is she? You know, is there someone out there that knows something about the whole thing? It just never goes away.
Michael Bernadette, thank you for coming in to us. The reason that we played that, I suppose, is to underline 4 years on from when that interview was recorded, nothing has changed.
No, nothing has changed. It never has changed from day one.
Do you still live every day thinking that every phone call, every knock on the door could potentially bring news?
Yes, we do. That's how our lives play out now. You're always hoping a phone call, as you say, a knock on the door, it flashes into your mind. Might this be the time that we get that piece of information that might make the difference?
That's an agonising way to live your life, Bernadette.
Well, we have no choice because that's the way it is for us. And we have to do our best and try and make as much progress as we can in our search for Deirdre.
It must feel quite cruel as well, watching Deirdre's friends grow up and presumably by this stage get married, have kids. You must end up reflecting on the things that she should have been doing.
That is particularly difficult. And also in view of the career that she was hoping to be a primary school teacher, I often think about that and where she might be now if she had completed her course.
And she was a happy girl. There was no reason to leave that you
know. No, she was quite happy and she was home for the summer holidays from London and she was enjoying the time at home and looking forward to when she might go back to college in the autumn.
Michael, is there a single day that these thoughts don't intrude?
No, every day, every moment of every day you can get those thoughts and they'll just take over your mind and you just have to not really set them aside, but you just have to work with those thoughts and live your life at the same time.
Now, somebody, at least one person, probably more than one person out there, knows something that could put this living hell to an end for you. What would you say to them if they're watching tonight?
We're saying to that person or persons out there that has some piece of information, there are so many ways that they can come forward with that piece of information. Now, that piece of information to those people may seem very, very small, very insignificant, but with a great amount of work that has been done on Deirdre's case, those little pieces of information may start to bring it all together and we could make meaningful progress.
What would it mean to you, Bernadette?
Well, it would mean that we would at least be able to make progress at last, because we feel that there is information out there. And I would say to you who is looking at this programme tonight, you may have some piece of information that can help us progress the situation. This could be your child, it could be your daughter, and you could be in our position. So please help us. If you have anything at all, maybe you can remember something from 1998, or maybe there's something that has come to your attention in the meantime, something, no matter how insignificant you may feel it is, it could make all the difference.
And we can see what a difference that would make to
yes.
you.
Yes.
Thank you very much for coming in to us this evening. Gráinne now is with Detective Superintendent Walter O'Sullivan to talk about the ongoing investigation.
Walter, it's impossible not to be moved by the bravery, number one, of the Jacobs coming in tonight to talk about Deirdre, but also the anguish that they're clearly living every single day since she went missing.
Yes, Gráinne, there are no words adequate to describe the heartache and despair that the Jacob family are experiencing 17 years later. It certainly is an experience that they're living with every day.
You're head of the Serious Crime Review Team, or what you might call a cold case unit, and you're looking at this case again. It's clear, listening to the family, that they knew very quickly that something was wrong the day Deirdre went missing, because there was no sign that she would go missing before she did.
This was an ordinary day for the Jacob family. Deirdre was at home. Mum and Dad were out working. And when Deirdre's mum came home, she knew intuitively that there was something wrong. And when Deirdre's dad and sister arrived home, within a short time they had made contact with the local guards in Newbridge to report Deirdre missing.
What is your role as part of the Serious Crime Review Unit in this case? What do you do?
My role and my job and the job of the investigators that work with me is to review all the information collected to date in the case, and to do so in order to establish further investigative opportunities, to open up new lines of inquiry, and to establish as to whether or not any criminality was associated with Deirdre's case, and also to ensure that everything that can be done is being done in relation to Deirdre.
A lot of time has passed, and I suppose when she went missing, time is not the friend of the investigator, but things are different now.
Well, time is always a challenge for the original investigators. But as time moves on, and we're now into the 17th year, Deirdre's missing for 17 years, time does and can become the friend of the investigator. Technology has moved on, forensic science has moved on. But relationships change as well, people who hold information, and attitudes change. And persons possibly who once held extreme indifference to the value of human life may now appreciate that life through the lives of their children and family. I would ask any person who has or holds information in relation to Deirdre not to assume that the guards have it, but to call in relation to it. Their information or your information, allied with information that we hold, may be of particular significance to Deirdre's case.
Okay, Walter, thank you so much. It's hard to imagine how anyone watching tonight who has information wouldn't come forward and help give some peace to Deirdre's family. Even if you think that what you remember is insignificant, please call and let the Gardaí decide. Philip.
Touch a deja vu to this month's Wanted on Warrant. We have shown you pictures of all of these men before, but Gardaí haven't caught up with any of them yet. So we're going to show them to you again. And the first man that we are looking for information on is 20-year-old Danny Carthy, originally from Cushlawn Park in Talla. Gardaí in Harcourt Street are looking for him if you've any idea where he might be. The guards in Harcourt Street are also looking for this man, Patrick Doran. Anything you have by way of assistance to catch up with this 26-year-old, last known address for him, a bench warrant has been issued for him at The Waterways, Salins, County Kildare. We showed you last month Isameldin Ibrahim, but he is still at large. He's 33 years old and he is wanted on foot of a European arrest warrant. The last man here is Carl Delaney. He is being sought by Gardaí in the extradition section. 37-year-old Carl Delaney, last known address, Railway Cottages, Salins, County Kildare. I know there are two Salins addresses there. There is a High Court bench warrant out for him. Now, separate to all of those warrants, Gardaí are also looking for a name that matches this face. This is an EvoFit, a computer-generated likeness, for a man wanted in connection with an aggravated burglary in Mulhuddart on the night of the 9th into the 10th of April. A couple were at home with their 9 and 2-year-old children when three men entered the house. This first man was over 6 feet tall. The other two were much smaller, 5'5 or 5'6. So, were you in the Avondale Park area of Mulhuddart that night after 11 o'clock, did you see this man with either of his accomplices travelling in a dark-coloured Ford Mondeo? Please ring the numbers on your screen if you did now. Moving on now to car theft and the increasingly common phenomenon of thieves targeting cars right outside your house.
Yeah, we look at two recent raids on family homes in Rathoe and Michel in County Carlow. Raid in Rathoe, County Carlow on the 1st of December last is one of two armed raids that occurred in the county within a fortnight of each other. The second raid was carried out on the 14th of December in Michel, and like the first raid, it was violent and intimidating.
Give me the keys! Where's the keys, your fucking car?
In both cases, the men were armed with sawn-off shotguns and metal bars.
Keys your car, listen to me! Give me the keys your car now! Now! Hurry up! Now! Now, hurry up! Come on, hurry up!
In the first raid in Rathoe, the men, unable to start the car, gave up, dropping the stolen car key as they fled.
Hurry up! Go, quick!
In the second raid, there were two cars in the driveway.
It's the wrong car.
Where's the keys of the Beamer? You! Where's the keys of the Beamer? Hurry up! Get them!
Fucking move!
Get him!
Come on, hurry up!
Don't move! That's enough. Here we are. Hurry up! Don't you dare move!
The raiders got away with the car they were after. A dark grey BMW 3 Series Coupe, registration 07D26941. Two families traumatised by men determined to get their cars. Now, taking a look at the first raid, it happened in Rathoe on the 1st of the 12th last year. Did you see anything suspicious in that area? It happened at 9:45 at night. That's at night. Did you see anything in the area that might make you suspicious?
And possibly related, maybe not. Gardaí have an open mind on this. But 2 weeks later, away from Rathoe, over the county, in Michel, this BMW 3 Series Coupe, slate grey in colour with a Dublin Reg 07 Reg car, was taken. That's on the 23rd of the 1st, 2015. And there could be some kind of a link, we don't know, between these two crimes, because that BMW story didn't end on that night. It went on to be used in an armed robbery, also in Carlow, 5 weeks later. On the 23rd of January, a cash and transit van drove into Bagnallstown, County Carlow, heading for the supermarket at the parade. It was almost 3 o'clock and the team's last stop of the day. They didn't notice a grey BMW coupe parked at the side of the supermarket waiting for them to arrive. BMW sped away in the direction of Dunleckney townland and Loughlin Bridge. They were only kilometres from the supermarket when the dye pack in the security box exploded. This forced the raiders to dump what they had stolen at gunpoint only minutes earlier. The box was found unopened on the side of the road just after Harrow Cross. Witnesses noted that the registration started with 08D,
It was the same grey BMW stolen in Meischl in December, a month earlier. The car was later discovered burnt out at the entrance to a field in Rahanlea, just a few kilometres south of where it had been stolen.
Stephen, quite a lot of activity there for potential witnesses to be able to come forward and assist you with. Remind us, when are we talking about?
We're talking from the 14th of December in 2014, when the car was taken from Meischl, until the 23rd of January of this year.
Yeah, we'll put that up on the screen there. 23rd of January, coming up to 3 o'clock
That's
in the
correct.
Afternoon. Yes. So almost certainly plenty of people around. But now, obviously, the key to your investigation here is going to be the car.
Yes, the movements of the car between the time it was stolen and the time it done the raid in the supermarket in Bagnestown.
Because there are 5 weeks here. Now, the car could have been anywhere, but logic would suggest it was probably holed up somewhere in Carlow, as it had been stolen there and was then used in a raid there.
Yeah, we believe it didn't travel too far from the Carlow area and that it had to be seen.
Now, it had false reg when it was involved in that raid on the 23rd of January, 08D, but pointedly, I suppose, Dublin reg, legitimate Dublin reg beforehand, and then this Dublin reg afterwards. Car like that, it might stick out around Carlow.
I would imagine it would stick out before around Carlow, yes.
Okay. Now, three possibly related crimes here. You're going to stay and take calls on all of them.
Yes, we're staying for the night and we'll happily take calls on any of the three crimes tonight.
Stephen, thank you very much for coming in. Good luck with your investigation. If you can help with this, please pick up the phone now.
Time for more CCTV now, Greg.
That's right. Now, our next piece is a discharge of a firearm from Black Horse Grove in Dublin 7. This occurred on the 22nd of January this year. Now, there's one man involved, and as you can see from the photo, he's very well covered. So if you have any information about the shooting there, about the show, we want you to get in touch with us tonight. So we'll just take a look at the footage of what actually happened on the night. So as he approaches here, we can see very clearly he's armed with a shotgun. Now, he does try to fire at the door, but the gun seems to jam, perhaps. He's unsuccessful anyway, and he takes a number of moments to try and fix whatever's wrong with the gun. He does manage to do that, and we can see very clearly then he lines it up again and he fires a shot through the door. We'll see the glass shatter now in a moment. The man makes his getaway, but shortly before that occurred, there was a dark-coloured saloon car seen in the area. It was possibly a Toyota Corolla 2000 to 2004 model. He shot through the front door. There were 9 people in the house at the time, including 5 young children. So thankfully, nobody was injured in this shooting. But as you can see, he's very well covered up.
He is. It's fair to say you can't see his face there.
Yeah.
And I suppose it's the reflection of the light and the fact that it's at night.
Yeah.
But somebody somewhere knows something about what happened. And as you said, a lot of people's lives were put in danger because
Absolutely.
Of that shooting.
So hopefully maybe with the description of the car, and maybe a little bit of information that somebody has, we might get a bit of a result tonight.
Please do get in touch. Okay, next we're going to look at a burglary in County Clare.
That's right. Now, this is from an auctioneer's on Chapel Lane in Ennis in County Clare. It's from the 12th of December last year. Now, that's the man we want to try and identify from it. Mm-hmm. So we'll just take a look at the footage that we have of this burglary. So, as we can see, the man wearing all black, a black cap, a black jacket and black trousers. Now, for a number of moments before he actually came to the door of the auctioneer, he walked up and down the street, and on the right-hand side of our picture, we have it circled. That's where the door is. So he slipped the lock of the door to get entry into this auctioneer's. Now, there was nobody there at the time. It was lunchtime, and he spent about 5 or 6 minutes inside before leaving. And as he leaves, we'll see he's carrying a laptop bag in his hand, which he didn't have earlier on in the footage, and it was subsequently discovered that a laptop and cash was missing from the office inside. So there he goes with the laptop bag. We'll just take a look at the photos we took from it. That's probably the clearest one we could get and perhaps recognisable to somebody. And if you do know who he is, please give us a call.
Okay, Greg, thanks, Minion, for that. If you do have any information, please pick up the phone.
Go on, Greg, thanks. That brings us to the end of part one. Still to come, though. Few of us are installing car seats properly, so we get a demo on how to do the job. And a family home in Dublin 15 is targeted. Can you help identify this man? See you after the break.
You're very welcome back to the programme. So far tonight, we've already had a very good response, Greg.
Yeah, the phones are really busy again tonight, so thanks for all the calls. And we have a couple of requests to reshow some of the photos we've seen in the CCTV. Mm. We've one from Nace. It was a robbery from a shop. So that's the man there yeah. we're looking to identify. So hopefully that'll be helpful to whoever was looking for that. And then the second request in to reshow something was from Ennis, the burglary in Ennis that we just saw before the break, where there was a laptop and cash discovered missing from an office, and that man was seen on CCTV. So whoever was looking for that again, thanks for the call, and hopefully that'll be of some assistance to you.
Okay, Greg, talk to you soon. Yeah.
Now to the part of the programme where we focus on road safety. The RSA has discovered that a shocking 80% of children's car seats are fitted incorrectly, which, if you have ever tried buying one that matches your car and figuring out the instruction manual, won't surprise you at all.
You won't compromise on your child's safety, so you pay good money for a child seat. But only one in five of us installs them correctly.
The impact of a collision on a child's body is very significant. In essence, you're talking about a child being propelled at great speed, often out the front window of the car or against the dashboard, and therefore they sustain both lacerations to the skin, significant head injuries, which may be irreversible.
So here at the Road Safety Authority Check It Fits, we have a child car seat checking service. So it's a free service. We have two experts on site who will check the compatibility of your car seat with your child and with your car. And they'll also teach you how to fit it correctly.
Children, the way their anatomy is, their heads tend to be heavier. Their necks are smaller and not as strong. The muscles of their neck are not as well developed. Their chest wall tends to be more elastic and doesn't tend to withstand pressure as much. They tend to have more serious injuries from only mild impact.
Okay, so a couple of things, okay? First of all, the harness was really loose on her, okay? So we need to address that. On the little babies, they were actually off the shoulder, were so loose. So we were able to show her that and show her what she should look for. Realistically, you should only be able to get two fingers on the top part of your shoulder under the strap, but would have difficulty or resistance turning it sideways. And that's how tight it should be. A lot of people come into us with those shoulder straps off, and that actually could be devastating in a crash.
We've checked almost 7,000 car seats so far, and what we found is that 4 in 5 are incorrectly fitted or they need adjustment in some way. So that's 80% of car seats that we do check need some type of adjustment.
The handle was down. In this particular seat, the handle in transit is always up. The base is quite loose, okay? And I can see that there's a problem with the leg. It's not actually sticking out the way it should do. Okay, so I can see straight away there's an issue here, because the problem is on this side it's perfect, and on this side the plastic has actually come on the wrong side, and that prevents it from actually going straight out.
Most seatbelts have the three-point harness. It is safer to have the three-point harness because it's therefore holding your top torso as well as the bottom. And you should just make sure that the lap belt is across their pelvis and that the diagonal belt is on their shoulders, so the hard parts of the body rather than the soft parts.
A group of injuries that we tend to call the lap belt syndrome, these are usually when children usually unhook the shoulder aspect of their restraint and are left with only the one that goes across the lower abdomen. They usually have injuries to their internal abdominal organs. They can get injuries to their spine as well, usually their lumbar spine as well.
I'm just absolutely shocked, to be honest. We do lots of travelling because we're up and down the north probably every 2 weeks. We're always in the car. I actually just can't believe it. I mean, I just wish I'd known this 10 months ago.
We're rolling out the Check A Fit service all around the country. We're on the road 50 weeks of the year, and you can check our website to see when we're in your local town.
We would continue to urge parents that it's vital that they restrain their children in an age-appropriate restraint until the age of 12.
Paul Keighley has joined us in studio now to go over some of the do's and the don'ts. 4 out of 5 are installed properly, but improperly. But break that down for me. What are the mistakes that are most commonly being made?
Okay. The most common mistake we make, or we see on this type of car seat, is where it's installed just way too loose. So when we check a car seat like this, we want to pull the harness in the centre of the seat, and it should be rock solid. It shouldn't come off the seat at all. So on this seat, if you see the way it moves, that's just really wrong.
You think that you've put the belt through properly, you think it's tight, but that movement, even in a braking situation, never mind a crash, is going to cause the child serious injuries.
Exactly. So with this seat, we want to pull it as tight as we can, pull the harness through, and it should be rock solid. It shouldn't move at all. So if we pull this here now, see the way it's going nowhere.
And it is an industry standard, isn't it, that there are red parts here that the belts are supposed to go through.
Exactly. So you have your red guides here. So for a forward-facing seat, it's always red guides. And also on the seats, there's instructions on the side of the seat which tell you how to install it. They are difficult to follow.
But not impossible.
But not impossible.
OK, let's take this one out and we'll go for the Rocket Hot, which is one that you see the same mistake being made quite frequently with. First thing, obviously, it is meant to be rear-facing, folks. It's a mistake you see quite a bit. But what happens here most
exactly.
often?
Exactly. And actually, when they mix up which side it goes, so when you see people put it in forward-facing, that is absolutely lethal. Mm-hmm. So it has to go rearward-facing. With this, the biggest mistake we see is people mixing up which belt goes where. So ideally, when we install this seat, we want the lap belt going over the baby's lap and the diagonal going around the back.
And not just ideally, you have to do it that way. The lap has to go over that belt. But what people are doing is, and just show us the wrong way to do it, you put the lap belt around the back.
Around the back. They fasten the seat belt in. They're putting the lap belt through the blue guide here.
And the diagonal over the baby's lap. Like that. It looks like it's secure.
Two fingers.
You wouldn't even have to break for that to happen.
Yeah.
That'd be absolutely lethal.
Stands no chance.
Okay, show us the right way to do it. I mean, it is as simple as lap belt goes over the child's lap.
Yeah, like I would always suggest with this seat, you fasten the seat belt in first. That lets you see which is your lap belt, which is your diagonal. Put the baby seat into the car. The lap belt, as I said, over the lap belt, under the blue guides, like so, and the diagonal belt just goes around the back and again under the blue guide.
And how often do you see that mistake being made?
We see it about in 1 in 5 cases we'll see people mix it up. But just to show you here how solid this is, it's going nowhere.
Okay, that's what very good. Then your child has grown up a little bit. We're at whatever, 3.5, 4 years of age. You've moved on to the booster seat. What's the most commonly made mistake here?
Yeah, again, with this type of seat, what we want is the belts coming through the horns like this, like that. And what that does is it positions the belts down on the child's pelvis. The biggest mistake we see is where parents put the belts actually over the horns like that. And what that does is it puts the belt up at the child's tummy area. And the belts will just cut through the tummy, doing serious damage to the child's internal organs. So with this one, it goes under the horns like that.
And that is the most commonly made mistake with all car
seats? That's the most common mistake we see. And we see that with this type of car seat in probably 3 out of every 5 cases.
Good Lord, 3 out of 5.
Yeah.
It's complicated for mums and dads. Nobody said that it was easy, but the person selling you these seats should know how to install them.
Absolutely. And when they're installing the car seat in your car, when they're selling you a car seat, they should be taking it out from the shop to put it into your car to check it fits safely. And then they should be showing you how to do it, because it's essential that you, the parent or guardian, knows how to keep their child safe in the car.
Great advice, Paul. Thank you very much for joining us this evening. I've made a good number of those mistakes myself. The reason, Derek, that we're doing this is because children, infants, is one of the largest area of growth in the fatalities numbers.
That's correct, Philip. Unfortunately, child fatalities more than doubled in 2014 compared to 2013. There was 16 deaths last year compared to 7, and certainly some of those involved a collision where a child was not properly restrained.
Okay. What advice would you add to what Paul has already given?
Well, I suppose we have to look at it that children are our most precious cargo. So apart from the obvious safety side, there is a legal requirement to make sure that children of every age are using not only the correct child restraint, but the child itself is properly positioned in it. You know, if your child wriggles free from the belt or the harness that they're in, or if they unbuckle the belt, parents or guardians must pull over to a safe place and do it again.
Because the surprise can frequently be enough to cause an accident itself as you look over your shoulder.
Absolutely, yeah. You're distracted. It may take more than one time to do it, but we really must impress on parents and guardians to make sure that their children, their most precious cargo, are restrained at all times.
Don't assume just because you've belted them in, or they say that they're belted in, that they actually are belted in at all. All right, Derek, thank you very much for that. If you want more advice on road safety, please visit the Garda or Road Safety Association websites. Details are on your screen now.
Gordy and Blanchardstown are looking for your help tonight after an aggravated burglary that occurred on Thursday, the 12th of February, at Hazelbury Green in Clonee in Dublin 15. Hazelbury Green is an estate located just off the Navan Road at Clonee in the northwest suburbs of Dublin. An aggravated burglary happened here in this quiet cul-de-sac on the 12th of February last. It was a Thursday morning. A woman in her 80s was at home. Her family were gone out to work for the day. At about 8:30, she thought she heard a door opening. She went to the window and a large silver-grey car was parked outside. Suddenly, a man burst into the room. The woman was terrified. He demanded money, but the woman who didn't speak English couldn't understand him. The raider brought her to the kitchen. His accomplice had already ransacked the room, searching for money.
Is this where the money is?
No.
He then moved her upstairs to her bedroom. He taped her mouth and began searching her room. The woman was feeling dizzy and confused. She was afraid for her life. He left her alone while he searched the bathroom, pulling tiles from the bath panel. She spotted the second burglar passing the doorway. He had a knife. He was of medium build and height, wearing a dark jacket, high vis, and a cream woolly hat. The house became quiet. It took some time for the woman to summon up the courage to look out the window. The silver-grey car was gone, and the burglars. Her house ransacked, the phone line dead, the woman called to her neighbours to help her. The burglars made off with the woman's handbag and purse. There is only one entrance to this estate. Were you in Hazelbury Green between 8:30 and 8:55 on Thursday the 12th of February? Ordeal for that elderly lady. How is she doing?
She's not doing too bad. She is recovering. She's obviously helped from her family. But in particular, like, she was in her 80s, so absolutely horrifying experience for her to go through.
It must be said, there was no money in this house. The raiders went to a tremendous amount of trouble to find something. There was nothing there to be found. What about security measures for the family since then?
Our crime prevention officer has been in touch, and obviously they have changed their security arrangements. But you're right, there was nothing for them to find. And this is sort of where we're sort of lost a little bit as to what they were actually looking for, what they thought they were looking for.
OK, well, the woman who was in the house worked very, very hard with the Gordy to put together this evil fit, which is the key to the case, really.
Absolutely,
let's talk about it.
Yeah. As I say, she is very, very happy with the evil fit. She said it's a really, really good likeness. She described him as 25 to 30 years of age. He was medium height, medium build, and he was wearing a high-vis jacket that went down to the waist. The second mate, she didn't get a great look at, but a similar build. But he was wearing a grey jacket and a cream woolly hat.
And he was the man holding the knife.
He was the man holding the knife.
As we said just in the piece, there's only one entrance to this estate, and this happened at a time when people would have been in and out of the estate, bringing children to school and perhaps coming home.
That's right. The estate is situated quite close to a school, and for vehicles, there is only one entrance and exit. So when the raiders went in, it would have been just before school, and then maybe mothers were coming back, having dropped their kids to school when the raid finished. So there would have been a lot of activity around the area at the time.
And it's an estate with plenty of young families, isn't
it? Absolutely, yeah, plenty of young families. And we would imagine this type of car acting in the way it may have acted would have drawn attention.
OK, well, hopefully someone tonight will remember something. Paul, thank you very much and the best of luck with your investigation. Can you bring this a step further? Did you see a silver car that day, or two men behaving suspiciously in the Hazelbury Green area? Does the evil fit look familiar? Any small detail or anything that felt out of place in that area that morning could help. And if you've been affected by a crime, help is available. Call 116 006.
Greg, even more crimes caught on CCTV. First of which is a re-show, a piece that you didn't get quite the response that you were hoping for last month.
That's right, so we're going to show it again tonight. It was a robbery from a shop on Lower Mount Pleasant Avenue, in Dublin 6 in January. Now, there's one raider we're looking to identify. That's a photo there. So we're going to show it again tonight because we didn't do as well as we did last month. So let's take a look at the footage. Now, he was in this shop for over 2 hours using the internet before he produced this gun to the staff member who's working there. The customer customers, the rest of the customers had left, and he went up and demanded money from the till, and he did end up getting some cash as well as a packet of cigarettes. But it's similar to the one we shown earlier on, where his scarf is covering the bottom half of his face and he's
but
wearing a hat.
But presumably not for the 2 hours that he was there.
But not for 2 hours he was there. And we have identified people before from similar photographs. So there's some more of them just holding the gun to that man there working in the shop. So again, it's a re-show, and hopefully tonight we'll do a little bit better and get a good call on it.
You know what? Even without the scarf, or with the scarf, he's still pretty recognisable. Hopefully you're going to get good leads on that man tonight. Now, staying in Dublin, you have a trespass case in Dublin 8.
That's right. This occurred last month on the 20th of March at 3:40 in the afternoon. An elderly woman was involved with this. We'll just take a look at the footage of what actually happened. So this red car pulled up. It looks kind of like a Hyundai coupe to this cul-de-sac in Rialto in Dublin. This man gone out, we get some very good images of him as he's approaching the door here of this house. Now, he spent a number of minutes knocking at the door until he got an answer. So the elderly woman comes to the door. This man begins to speak to her. He tells her that he's a tradesman working in the area and asks, can he come into her house? She refuses, but the man goes in anyway, and he begins to enter a number of rooms. But the woman was very quick thinking. She went outside. She began to call for help from her neighbours. And as this happens, the man straight away leaves. Now, he does spend a moment talking to her, but he does get out of there quite quickly. And as he's walking away, that red car follows alongside him there. So the woman has upgraded her security since this. We did get some really good images of him, though, while he was going from the car to the door. And hopefully tonight someone can put a name to that face.
Do you know, it's especially heartening to see, though, a community response when somebody does call out, and that quickly, that she wasn't left standing there herself. All right, worth making the observation again that we don't always see that kind of community response. It's nice when it does.
It's nice when it works, and it kind of had an effect because he left quite quickly there.
Okay. Now, the last piece that we want to look at here is just stills. We don't actually have moving images of the man you're looking for.
No, we're just going to show a couple of photographs. It's from a theft incident from the 28th of January last year from Kilmallock in County Limerick. Now, that's the man we want to identify in relation to items that were stolen from this garage. But we're just going to take a look at another photo of the car that he arrived in. It was a Golf, a red Golf. It looks kind of like a sporty model, new enough looking Golf with black alloys on it. And again, we just have a photo of him when he was in the garage that he stole some items from. So if you know that man, it's probably our clearest of the night, and we don't have a video of it, but very good images of him, and hopefully tonight we'll get an identification for him.
No doubt about it. Easily the most recognisable of all of the images that you've come in with tonight. Greg, thank you very much for that.
Calvin, we're here to talk about keeping your home and your valuables safe. And you've got some footage to show us which proves the three-minute rule. Maybe you can tell us what that means.
Grania, the footage we're about to see demonstrates greatly this three-minute rule. And it's generally believed that if you can keep an intruder out of your home for up to 3 minutes, they'll move on to another target because of the fear of getting caught. Mm-hmm. And what we see here in this footage is this homeowner had an excellent, sturdy front door that took a fair battering here from these guys trying to get into their home. And what it demonstrates is that even though he has a good CCTV system, he's a good alarm, and motion detecting, lighting, that sort of thing, what stood between those intruders and his property was that front door. So it's a good example of good barriers for intruders trying to get into your house. Mm-hmm. If you're thinking about changing your door or trying to improve your security, we'd recommend getting a good quality door, a PASS 24 2012 door.
It would a sort of a quality mark, isn't it?
It is. What it looks is, it looks into the quality of the door, the quality of the locks, the quality of the hinges, makes it a robust door. It's also a standard for windows as well. But more than that, we're asking people again, reminding people to make sure that the doors are locked, particularly when they're out of their homes, and to put on their alarms when they're away, even when they're at home at night, and when they're storing their car keys, to store them safely.
You have brought us on to the next question. It's a crime that has really increased in the last while, even though we've raised awareness of it in the past, phishing.
It's actually doubled in 2 years. We've seen 218 cases of this last year, of car keys being fished through letterboxes and cars merely being whizzed away from houses because people have just left their cars, car keys on the hall table. And we can see here in the footage here of cars being car keys being whipped away. We're asking people not to store their keys by hall tables. Maybe think about getting a door, a letterbox limiter or restrictor on their letterbox. It's a tool, I suppose, that stops people from putting in those rods through the letterboxes. Stops people from getting their hands in through letterboxes as well. They're quite inexpensive. It's a good thing to get for your door, and to invest in something like that is a good idea.
Of course, we have seen earlier on in the programme raids where people did gain entry into a house just to get the keys. If that happens, there's only one thing you should do.
Absolutely, Grainne. It's hand over the keys. Your own personal safety is worth a lot more to you than a car. And just make sure you get in touch with us as soon as possible. And there's plenty more advice on the Garda website if anybody wants to see.
And it's not just high-powered cars that get stolen. Ordinary family saloon cars get stolen too, and you are managing to return many of them.
Yeah, we return about 6 out of 10 cars that are stolen. You're looking at about 1,500 cars stolen last year. We return about 6 out of 10 of them. They're usually the cars targeted are 1,400 to 1,600 cc cars, not just your high-powered cars. They were very much the exception. But again, as I say, look to the Garda website.
Okay, absolutely. Lots more advice for keeping your valuables safe there.
We are almost out of time. A little bit of a lull in the calls there, but you can see the pink sheets of paper all over the table. So there has been good, steady business tonight.
There has. It's going really well. And please keep the calls coming in if you do have some information. We have a request to see one of the Evo fits from Hazelbury, again, that was on earlier on in the programme. We'll just take a look at that there. So
it's very brief show. One of the guys who held that 80-year-old woman upstairs. All right, Greg, I'm afraid we're out of time. Right. Thank you very much. Our call takers are here, though. Until 11:30, please do keep the calls coming.
Your information is what makes all the difference.
We'll be back with you on Monday, the 25th of May.
Good evening. Good night, Jarib.
Good night.
A punter doing a little too well on the tables is firmly on Vincent's radar when we head to Vegas tonight at 11:35. Clareburn Live is on the way next. More on that during the break.